The views and opinions of the hosts and guests are their own and do not necessarily reflect the position of the management and staff of Guardian Network. I'm not afraid. I'm not afraid to take a stand.
Take a stand. Everybody, everybody, come take my hand. See you live off the record with Zhivargo Laing, sponsored by Iraq Bank and Trust and Royal Star Assurance.
To Z Live. I'm Zhivargo Laing, your host. So glad you could join us here today on Guardian Radio 96.9 FM on this beautiful Thursday afternoon. So glad you could join us. And I have with me today the one and only Laverne Gardner. Mrs. Laverne Gardner is joining me today. And we're going to have a conversation in not too long a while. But if you want to give us a call on 323-6232, please feel free to do so, or 325-4316 or 325-4259. You can text us on 422-4796 or you can WhatsApp me on 439-3043. We are live on Cable Bahamas, channel 969, and that's the way my mother listens to the show. You can catch us on BTC Flow channel 612. That's BTC Flow channel 612. I do want to note, producer, that someone from the organizers of the upcoming Karifta Games is going to call into the show. So if you get that call, please feel free to pass it through. Laverne Gardner, welcome, ma'am.
Hi, how are you?
I am mostly good. Some days I don't know, but you know, today I think I'm okay.
Well, you know what? It's okay. I like to check in with myself daily, and I do the same thing. Sometimes I'm all right for the whole day. Sometimes not so much. So it's all right.
Yeah. And I'm not even pretending myself when it ain't okay. I can say, boy, today ain't a good day, is it?
Right.
And that's so, ladies and gentlemen, I have with me today from Mixed Views, Laverne Gardner. Again, so glad you could join us. So, you know, yesterday we had a very interesting conversation about NIB and then about the National Investment Fund. And at the end of the show, one of the callers, a caller called in, and if he wanted to call back, he could do so. But he started this conversation about a National Development Plan. We needed a National Development Plan because that would prevent us from having projects start and not continued, et cetera. And I promise to continue that discussion today because I honestly don't know how to end this discussion about something people say that I think is both historically inaccurate, but also a bit strange for people who vote for change. Okay, so remember the backdrop of his conversation about the National Development Plan was that, you know, one administration comes in, meets a project going on, and then changes it and stops it, right? And so I hear that a lot, that things don't continue. And I keep asking people, give me examples. Give me examples of that. And honestly, beyond saying it happens. Very few people can give me any significant examples of that. And by significant, I mean a reasonable number or any significant such project. Now, I don't know if you could help me out. Maybe you have some
examples. I think what happens is people...
More on the examples in terms of thing, but yes, go ahead.
Yeah. I think in terms of people look at, let's use examples like this. If, and it escapes me. Hopefully it'll come back to me. There was, urban renewal. And then you have urban renewal 2.0, a different iteration of it because it's under a different, there is a different party who's the government. Or maybe they see contracts that were going along and have expired and now they're not being renewed because this government has determined that they're going in a different right direction. And so we're reviewing this that took place in the previous government, and that there's like I said, a different iteration of it, or it doesn't start again. And you get the feeling as if it's almost like commercial I used to hear. It was like New Zion Baptist and then the new Zion Baptist and then Zion Baptist, right? And so you're seeing perhaps different iterations because each government specific may want to focus on what they deemed was important with that project or whatever decision that was made that may not have been necessarily the same way that the previous government looked at it. So you get this feeling of, are we really making progress? Is it really, you know, going in the right direction? Or we have this food assistance program people were benefiting from, but we have to review it now. It's not called the food assistance program. We're going to do it in a different way.
But let's hold on. Mm-hmm. Let's stick with your first example, urban renewal. Stick with the first example, which is kind of like my point. And I think you're making the point brilliantly in the way you are emphasizing or detailing what people's perception of it might be. So, urban renewal. So, the question is, did the project continue? And the answer is, was the line item in the budget removed? No. Were the centers closed? No. Were programs still emanating out of the centers? Yes. Did one administration emphasize community policing activity in urban renewal versus another one? We're emphasizing projects and programs? Yes. Did they change the personnel in the centers? Mm-hmm. After the administrative change by not renewing some contracts, for sure? Yes. Okay, that would be the extent of the modification. So let's take each in turn. And you said it. So you vote for change. You say, I want a new administration because I don't like what the old administration was doing. The new administration comes in and says, well, I don't think police officers in urban renewal centers is the best use of police officers. So I'm going to take them out there and I'm going to leave the people who do you urban renewal, dealing with the communities and stuff like that. Is that an end of the program or is it a change because you voted for change?
Right, but let's take into consideration again, I voted for change, but in most cases when I vote for change, I'm not voting for complete change in everything. Let me put it like this. I don't want change to take place overall, widespread. I want change to take place in areas that I believe, or to my mind, based on what I'm seeing, experiencing, is not working. But where there are programs or policies in place that I am benefiting from that work for me. When you change those, that's a problem. You know what I mean? I don't want everything to change. I just want the things to change that I believe are not working.
Understood, right?
But that should change.
I understand, right? But you are one of the voters, right? You're one of the voters, right? So you didn't vote for change, but you didn't sit down with somebody and say, now listen, when you go there, don't change A. You could change B and C, but don't change D. Except that's not how we vote. We vote for a new leadership to make judgments on our part, right? And so if the leadership now starts assessing the resources that are being deployed because you get upset that it's you're changing that one. That doesn't mean everybody gets upset, because I can assure you, you and I both know this, right? Let me help you in case nobody wants to let the top off the bottom, right? Many of the centers, when political parties get opportunities to employ people in a center, it has an opportunity to employ people there. I'm sorry, a great number of those people are going to be people they believe supported them.
Absolutely.
Okay, so when the new party comes in and changes things and changes people, you think those people who wanted things to change are similarly saying, oh, why are you changing? You think so? I think not. So it's not there's no one we who gets to say, why are you changing it? Because some people like the change and some people don't. But the judgment is left to the people who get elected, because you elected them and gave them that power.
Power too, right?
So you when change happens, to expect a new group to come in and just, well, to decipher, well, I know this set want the thing to stay and this set don't want to step. You make judgments about the correctness, appropriateness, and the effectiveness of a program. That's the judgment you have been given. And sometimes you make the judgment, I don't like that emphasis, et cetera. But that is not the same as you ended the program when it was started by another administration. You may modify it. But again, even urban renewal is still just an example people throw out there. I'm asking for this mantra that every administration changes and you have these changes. Where are the significant things that get changed? Do our economic policies change? Meaning, are we still emphasizing foreign direct investment, some domestic and some support for domestic investments? Is our monetary policy changing? Is our education policy changing? The major massive things that move us in a direction, are they changing? And the answer is no, because most of the same people say, ain't nothing changing in the Bahamas. Right? So it's a tinkering around the edges when we talk about things that change. Junior achievement has been around from Sir Lyndon Pending days. Ingram came in, junior achievement remains. Christie came in, junior achievement remains. Minnis came in, junior achievement remains. Davis came in, junior achievement remains. No change. And you could say that for program after program, policy after policy, project after project. This notion of changes being not continued or things not being continued is certainly just really a fallacy. It is. It cannot be substantiated in any meaningful way. Cannot be.
Well, I think, like I said, it's really based more on your feeling that if the government changes every 5 years and there is a different iteration of a program, there's an adjustment, we always seem to make the adjustment only seems made when governments change. Are we just changing because I want my version of it, not necessarily because it works better? And then if I'm doing that, how much progress am I really making?
But again, though, let's I'm asking, let's look at the Whaley program, man. It's like the weighty thing. Okay, so I change a name of something. What is it doing? See, you have to take a deep dive into the project and ask, what is it doing? Is urban renewal still feeding people, still reaching out to people, still? So you have to look into that. People don't do that when they start making noise about these things. Mostly you hear the noise made when people lose their jobs because they say, oh, they didn't continue our contract because they believe he's PLP or he's FNMs, right? That's the kind of noise. But I'm talking not, I'm not talking to the people who are going to have that view no matter what information is given to them. If we are going to really speak intelligently about the things that happen in the country, we have to appreciate that while there is room for my opinion, I do have an obligation to look at the facts. And right. That's what I'm asking. I'm not, this is not about how you feel. This is not about how you know, what others have been saying they feel. It's about the facts. And I'm saying this is a country. It has institutions, it has policies, it has laws, it has programs, it has projects, it has procedures. I cannot find people who can say to me, look at this number of policies that have changed simply because the government changed. Look at this number of this laws that have changed simply because the government changed. That's not what people are talking about. People are talking about many times things they can't even name. And so if I asked the vast majority of people who make that claim, please sit down and on a piece of paper, write for me 10 projects discontinued simply because the government changed. They couldn't do 5 or 3. Couldn't do it. And the reason for that is simple. It's not true. It's a perception born of political rhetoric more than born of facts.
But to that point, isn't that though how most of our feelings, opinions, the things that we say is based on?
Yeah, except that's where the more informed, learned, and those of us trying to stretch us come into the picture. I'm not trying to join the chorus of unobserved. We are trying to push the mantle so that people can think about how they think about stuff. That's where we grow. You don't grow finding things that support what you say all the time. You grow when you find something that doesn't support what you say. There is something called the scientific method. A scientist, contrary to popular belief, does not go into a lab to prove himself or herself right. The scientist goes into the lab to find something that proves what he or she is thinking is wrong. So if a scientist sees 1,000 black cats leading him or her to think all cats are black, the scientist knows that I only have to find 1 white cat to prove that all cats are not black. So we don't run around trying to think and feel, oh, this is the case. Let's just look at the facts. Do the facts contradict what I'm saying is the question. Even if you find an instance, and I'm sure you could find an instance, maybe a couple of instances, where things have not continued because the government has changed, does that a case make for things changing because the government changes? And when you vote for change, why are you surprised when change happens? Why would one administration simply carry on a project because it was started in another administration? It could very, if Ingram believed that, we may not have today free media, private media, because that was started under another administration. We might not have days on which you go to license your vehicle on your birthday, because it used to happen one day in March, and so we could have continued that. But you get change, we change. Now, you could argue, some people, I didn't like that change. I thought that program was good, but that's life.
That's right.
Because you live in a
diverse. And typically, that's where the argument comes from for the person or people that are outside that are not in with the day-to-day running of a program or do not know all of that or all of what it takes for a program to run. If I, me, the public, the voter, I am benefiting from a program, participating in a program, for all intents and purposes, to my mind, it is working and having the impact, and people who are in the program, or we are kind of all in agreement with that, but then the program changes. To myself, why are we changing this program?
I could see that, but that's the problem, isn't it? Because my self-serving interest is not how government should work. That's how you should work for you. It's not how the government should work. The government works to make judgments about what works best for most, if not all of us. Because if you started governing for the people whose interests are served in a thing, why wouldn't I just make sure when I get in, I do stuff for my political people?
Well, we could argue that because, you know, the feeling is also that happens as well. So decisions are made
that to
benefit the support of those people who may have voted for you.
That is a feeling people have, but I can tell you it is also something that flies in the face of the fact that I can only speak from my experience. When I was in government, I can't tell you how many times I would hear from FNMs after having been elected, oh, y'all only taking care of PLPs still. In fact, I recall distinctly, I met a young lady working at National Insurance Board in the summer, right? She was in my constituency, she was working at National Insurance in the summer. She said to me, I didn't know her from Adam. I only learned subsequent that she was the granddaughter of a bishop who was a serious supporter, right? But she said to me, Mr. Laing, you know, if there ever is an opportunity at NIB for permanent placement, I'd like to be considered. When NIB did have some openings, I submitted her name. By this time, I'd learned who she was, mind you. And I submitted her name anyways, right? And I can't tell you the hell I catch from FNMs about it. And that happens. And it happens because I can only tell you about the experience I have, Mr. Ingram.
Right.
Zhivargo, listen to me. We are the government of all the people. All the people. I remember coming up to the election. It was like a couple of weeks before election. A colleague came to me and told me, did y'all give a grant to X, Y, and Z? I said, we did. Y'all are going to cost me this election because people are in an uproar in that constituency about it, that this big time PLP could get that and so forth. So I listened and that was it. I went and talked to Mr. Ingram. And Mr. Ingram, I said to Mr. Ingram what the colleague said to me, because we were on election time. He's the leader of the party, leader of the country. And Mr. Ingram said, did they get it fairly? I said, sir, according to the criteria. And he said, well, what you want me to do? And that was that. But you can't tell people otherwise.
Well, but let's also say, and again, you were only speaking from your experience. Can we also say, because you may not know personally, but can we also say that the opposite may be true? There are people who receive.
Yes, I can say that. I can say that assuredly, but here's what I will not say. What I'm not saying is because I have that example that everything happens that way. That's why I don't want people to say the other, because they have an example that everything works that way. All I am saying is, in the face of it, we have to be able to accurately say, oh, it's my belief that, or we can say, you know, I know instances of, etc. But that is not what we're doing. We oftentimes are casting aspersion on the whole system based on an anecdote.
Well, that is what we do, yes.
Yeah, but intelligent people, listen again. I'm not trying to keep folk where they are. I'm trying to stretch us. That's why I do the show the way I do it. I'm trying to stretch us. I'm not trying to cushion, pamper, or nurture a bad way of thinking. I'm trying to nurture a better way of thinking. That's the aim. And I think that anybody who has a public platform ought to have that same interest. I could be popular pandering. I could be popular trying to nurture good feelings about me agreeing with you or with somebody, anybody. But I'm saying the mandate is, can we stretch each other? The Bible says, as iron sharpens iron, so a man sharpens the countenance of his friend. And sharpening does not feel good, but in the end, it works well. That's the aim. You're listening?
That's your aim.
That's my aim, yeah.
I want you to qualify that because I don't always get that feeling that is always everyone's aim. I want to, and we can come back to the National Development Plan, but you mentioned about pandering.
Mm.
And not yesterday, the day before, I believe it was on the show, you were talking about the comments that the Prime Minister made in the House about not being, about being unable to produce the report when the emergency orders expired, and he was unable to do it. His reason was that because there wasn't, and I'm paraphrasing, documentation or information that he could access to be able to compile this report, right? And I'm using this in pandering because when I listen to the words that he used.
Mm-hmm.
But I feel sometimes words are used intentionally to create a diversion, to create a certain sort of feeling. So, and I'll give you an example. So he says that people hear that. You did a great job of breaking down how the systems work so that there's no way there could be no documentation, right? But for the person who does not know that, didn't have that information, you walk away from that thinking what? That maybe there was some opportunity, something happened, some sort of malfeasance took place. There's absolutely no documentation. They can't find anything. So your focus no longer is the fact that this report was not done and it should have been done. And it doesn't make sense to say that you can't find any documentation. You now walk away saying, what did the former government do? They were stealing everything, because you know everything, we quick to say you were stealing everything, right? Now, granted, the Prime Minister didn't come out and say there was theft involved, but I'm just saying the wording you use now gives this kind of feeling, this pondering to that, because you know that there's a section of society that you were well acquainted with that will run with that. And now the focus then becomes what the FNM did, what the FNM didn't do, what they did with the money. And we're back to where the VAT money is.
Yeah.
And I believe it, in my observation, and it's not just this government, governments use things like that. The whole campaign, really and truly, if we are honest, was run on where the VAT money at.
Yeah.
Only now to then come and say, okay, the VAT money is in the consolidated fund where all monies go.
Well, that's the political play. You see,
right.
Even for me, I'm not overly concerned about the political play, because to expect that will not happen is to expect the unrealistic. It is more important for me to sharpen my ear than to be concerned about the dull tongues of the people who speak to me. Because I can't control the tongues of the people who speak to me, but I can control how I hear. You know, the parable of the sower is all about being careful how you hear. Because the details you got in the parable of the sower was not about the seed, because you don't know what seed it was, what kind of seed. The most details you got about the soil. Because depending on the soil, you get production from the seed. That's about how you hear, how we hear. And I have to train my own self to listen in a way that I can tell where garbage is being sent my way, deception is being sent my way, inaccuracy is being sent my way, misdirection is being sent my way. Because if I am a keen hearer, even if I don't at first understand, I can at least have a cautious suspicion enough to look for more information and to ask more questions, right? And so trying to try, I cannot control a politician's mouth. Cannot. I can control my hearing as a voter, though. And that happens, that gets sharpened through experience, that gets sharpened through inquiry. And that's what we have to be about. But we have to require that of ourselves first. Because if I can shoot off anything to anyone without any kind of credibility to it, then why am I expecting someone else not to do the same thing to me? Right? Anyway, we're going to take a break. Ladies and gentlemen, you're listening to Z Live. I'm here with Laverne Gardner of Mixed Views, and we'll be back. We were continuing a conversation that started yesterday about the National Development Plan against the backdrop of projects starting and ending when administrations change. We'll be back right after this break.
So much going on in the world today, owning cash at your business can be risky. Let Fidelity offer you and your customers safety, convenience, and the flexibility of a fixed or mobile terminal. Take it with you, on the move and on the go, because business should never stop. For more details, speak to one of our business development officers at 356-7764 in Nassau or 352-6676 in Freeport. Visit our website at fidelitygroup.com or visit us at any of our branches.
It's a new year, and you're super excited to start the year off right. You've made your New Year's resolutions, doing more exercising, healthier eating, saving more, making better decisions and all that. If you have information or products that encourages healthy living, promotes sound financial decisions, or even promotes a positive lifestyle, one smart decision is to advertise in the Nassau Guardian's Healthy, Wealthy, and Wise supplement. So if you're a physician, speech, massage, or physiotherapist, own a gym, nutrition, or restaurant, does your financial insurance institution or credit institution have the plan for investing wisely? Then that information should be in the Nassau Guardian's Healthy, Wealthy, and Wise supplement. One low price gives you an ad in the supplement plus 15 30-second commercials. Interviews also available on Star 106 Hits, Guardian Radio, and Hot 91. Contact your account executives or the Nassau Guardian now. Start the new year right in the Nassau Guardian's Healthy, Wealthy, and Wise supplement.
This is Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM. Fresh news, smart talk, all day.
I'm not afraid to take a stand, everybody.
Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen, to Bank Zhivargo Laing, your host. So glad that you could join us here today on Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM on this beautiful Thursday afternoon. So glad you could join us. If you want to give us a call, the numbers are 323-6232 or 325-4316 or 325-4259. You can text us at 422-4796, or you can WhatsApp me by on 439-3043. I'm here with Mrs. Laverne Gardner, who is the host, Tess, of Mixed Views, that comes on Laverne.
Friday, 6 o'clock p.m., right on Facebook on our Mixed Views page.
All right. And so I'm not co-hosting this Friday, but, you know, I've been on there a couple of times now, so
Who says you're not co-hosting this Friday?
Because you are organized. You send me a note and let me know when I be on.
Well, if my guest, who I've been after since last week, doesn't give me an answer, you may get a midnight guest from me.
Available. I'm available anytime. All righty, Mom.
You may very well get a midnight text from me that says, "Hey,
no problem." So yesterday when the mention was made of the National Development Plan, I believe that the Bahamas should embrace a National Development Plan. There is now a second draft of such a plan. The Government and Public Policy Institute at the University of the Bahamas had reviewed the plan and made some recommendations under the Minnis administration regarding a way forward for the National Development Plan. The Prime Minister at an event of the Government and Public Policy Institute spoke to a National Development Plan and indicated his administration's intent to proceed toward the adoption of such a plan. It is in the Progressive Liberal Party's plan for the National Development Plan to be adopted. So a plan is, let's say, afoot. Right?
Okay, that's a safe way to say it.
Yeah. Now, before I go further, we have a call on the line, so let's take that call. Go ahead, caller, we're listening to you.
Laing, how you doing?
Yes, sir.
You know, people say people, but that you write anything on it.
You know, you provoke the conversation continuation, sir.
Yes, sir. My question, Mr. Laing, what legacy issues or problems have the government, any government, solved in the last 20 years? We've had issues in education.
So 20 years would be from 2003.
Right. Okay. We've had problem with crime has been escalating. We've had issues with electricity costs, BPL. We've been saying for years we need to grow our food. And the one administration, they started BAMSI, the next administration come in, they say, BAM!
Man, why you calling the show trying to cause problems, man?
I am trying to find out.
Why would you do that?
What?
You heard the question. You heard the question you asked. What major problem have we solved in the last 20 years? That's a big question.
Let's
you and I and Laverne see if we could think of one in the last 20 years that we have solved. So let's say in the last 20 years, did we solve the problem of the slow growth rate of the Bahamian economy? And the answer is no. Because in the last 20 years, the average growth rate of the Bahamian economy was like 1% or less.
Okay.
Did we solve the problem of high unemployment in the Bahamas? The answer is no, because we have had double-digit unemployment in the country since over all that period of time. So, can you help me? Crime did go down during the pandemic.
That's not a solution.
The murder rate in the Bahamas did begin to decrease and decrease by 20% prior to the pandemic.
Mm-hmm.
And the deficit started to go in a downward direction prior to the pandemic.
You know, Mr. Laing, I want to say this, and I agree with, you know, I think, and you know, like Laverne, I think we need to be focused, and I think it's important for us to understand that the opposition is also part of the government.
Mm-hmm.
They are part of the government, that they have a constitutionally appointed post. And so they are part of the governance of this country as well. And so, you know, and I applaud Mr. Pintard. He has been reaching out to this government, inviting them and putting forward their plans. And so unless we have a collaborative effort of everybody coming together, and then that's when that we can move forward. But like I said yesterday, we keep on doing, we have spent so much money on education, on immigration. This one buy this software for $40 million, and that one come and they throw the software. This one come here, they spend money on this. And
when you see somebody buy software and throw it away, give me an example of that.
No, but I say they change it. They go ahead and they say this ain't working, okay? And they change it. Road traffic. I understand we're supposed to have this system in place where you're supposed to be able to, they could see your license plate and this and that and all of these things. And then when the next government come in, oh, we aim for that. But that's our money that we've already invested in it, Mr. Laing. Do you know, yesterday I said that we allocated $17 million to deal with lawsuits. You know, each of citizen of Bahamas at 500,000 citizens, each of us could get $3,000 from that.
Yeah, but your passion on the subject is not going to permit me to believe that it is true. Not that you're trying not to be truthful, but to believe that things are what you say, because you are only talking about what you hear. So I don't know. I have no evidence of any software having been implemented, and then the government changing, and then they tossing that in the corner. I'm not aware of that,
Mr. Laing. Okay, I will check it out, and you can find out from the powers that be at road traffic and immigration, right?
Yeah.
The amount of money that was spent on software in order to facilitate these easy things, and for some reason, it didn't work or whatever.
Let me tell you why I'm suspicious of it. Because I know that it is possible for the government to invest in software and for it not to be used. I know that to be true. I know that from my own experience. But sometimes a part of that isn't the software itself. It's the resistance to the necessary training and usage of the software because of people's prior experience and comfort. I know that to be true.
Yeah, I agree. But Mr. Laing, and I go back to when you were part of the government. Do you remember when that contingent came from Malaysia? And they said that we were going to have e-passports and e-things and I think we spent, what, $10 million for them?
No, sir. Hold on. Now you're backing up a tree that I can speak to because I led the project. The contingent didn't come from Malaysia. We engaged the Singaporean government to provide consultancy service to us on e-government. Mm-hmm. And in point of fact, it was the project did cost $10 million. The project came in under budget and on time, and we delivered e-government. And what happened was we overlaid the platform with seven services, the first of which was driver's license renewal.
Right.
My wife was the first person in a live demonstration on launch day to have her passport renewed on the platform.
Right.
And we lost office shortly thereafter, and the project was supposed to be expanded. That platform remains in place, that infrastructure today, though.
Yeah, but again, I see. Did the next government build on what you started?
Why is it only now today that we can access
these services?
Yeah, but see,
you can be way down in
Hold on, man. Listen. I honestly, I'm trying to help people educate themselves. I do not want us to provide inaccurate information to people. Because the first argument was you stop the project and throw the program away. But I just said the software and the infrastructure remains in place and being built upon now. You then asked me if they built on it. And I'm saying, yes, it did. Not as quickly as I think they could have, but they did. And they are now building on that further. You have e-passports in the Bahamas now.
Yeah, but that's like 20 years later, Mr. Laing.
Listen, but I don't see, my friend, listen, I agree with you, but you know what is not productive? It is never productive to talk about what I didn't do.
No, what I'm talking about, if your wife could have gotten it then, back then, in that same short period of time, why did it take 20 years for the whole country to progress at that same state?
But I don't have an answer for that, but how does that help me get further today? I only want to
We have to go back and say, well, why did the next administration administration after that and after that? 20 years later, we are just now able to do what we should have been able to do, according to you, in a matter of minutes. That's not progress in my book.
Okay, I got you. Thank you much. Let me tell you something. Y'all know this, Zila. You don't get the luxury of moving the goalpost when you call. First of all, if you say something that's not accurate, at least acknowledge the inaccuracy of what you say first before you go on to the next point. Am I making sense, Laverne, or not?
You're making sense.
Right? So don't move the goalpost on me. The first point was the people get this off and then throw it out the window. I'm telling you that did not happen. So now you're saying we should have moved faster. But even if a fella runs do you know that how many times the world record in 100 meters was broken? Multiple times.
More than once.
Exactly. Which means that it could have been broken earlier than it was, right?
Right.
So I'm just saying we have to be a little more productive in our conversation about these things so that it isn't a narrative. That's my point.
Building on a narrative that's already out there.
Exactly. And this is the stretch, man, because we don't.
Do you? Yeah. I want to ask you, though, even just in talking about what narratives are out there and creating narratives, and, you know, you hear something out there and, excuse me, you don't, in some instances, you are unaware of the full story. In some instances, the full story or the way it works is not provided for you. And so this narrative that's out there that is inaccurate is perpetuated. Mm. Do you feel or think that if we have a functioning, available, correct me if I'm wrong, because to date I don't believe that we do, but I could be wrong. I could have missed something. Freedom of Information Act that details what governments, not just this government, did, were doing, it would help to prevent some of these narratives that are just based in pandering and inaccuracies.
Let's get to it when we come back from the break. A great question. Ladies and gentlemen, you're listening to Z Live. I'm Zhivargo Laing, your host. We have to take a break for news, and when we come back, we will continue our conversation. I'm here with Mrs. Laverne Gardner of Mixed Views. We'll be back after this break.
Sarah, how are you doing?
Okay.
Are you sure? I noticed you've been down lately.
Yeah, sometimes I don't know. I can't really put into words how I'm feeling, but I know I don't feel like myself sometimes. There's just so much going on in my life. School, friends, sports. Sometimes I worry about depressed.
I'm glad you're talking to me. And it's okay to talk about your feeling. It's normal to feel changes depending upon what's going on around you.
Yeah?
Of course. All of us should be concerned with our mental health and our well-being. Good mental health means that we can cope with our everyday stresses. You can talk to me anytime when you feel like it.
Okay. We should have these check and talks more often and take things from there.
Message is brought to you by PAHO WHO and the Ministry of Health and Wellness.
What risks do inflation, soaring energy prices, and global tensions pose to the Caribbean? Join international experts, local professionals, and policymakers at the 9th Annual RF Economic Outlook. Be part of the conversation on March 14th by reserving your seat today at rfbeo.com. RFEO 2023 is proudly sponsored by RF Bank and Trust, Alive Doctors Hospital, Fidelity Bank, J.S. Johnson, PwC, and The Tribune.
This is Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM, Nassau, Bahamas.
I'm not afraid, to take a stand, Everybody, come take my hand, We'll walk this road together, through the storm, whatever weather.
Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen, to Z Live. I'm so glad you could join us here today on Guardian Radio 96.9 FM on this beautiful Thursday afternoon, where I'm here with Mrs. Laverne Gardner of Mixed Views. You can hear that on Fridays at 6 p.m. Laverne, no, she don't play. She don't joke around. She's a soul real conversations on Mixed Views. Laverne, again, welcome.
Always a pleasure to be here.
So you had asked a question, so repeat it for us, only because I'm so young that I just don't always remember. And I don't want to miss your point.
No problem. What I'm saying is, could we dispel a lot of the misinformation or some of the misinformation that may be out there in terms of what is happening with government and the rest of that, if we had a Freedom of Information Act, which would what government has done, so we get a better understanding?
The short answer is yes. I mean, we do have a Freedom of Information Act. It's not
right.
Fully operational yet, apparently, as we need it. But yes, of course, if I could get a piece of information that answers a question that I legitimately have, especially press and the press and people who are serious researchers, that could be helpful to help dispel some things. But it is not true that information dispels myths and misinformation for everybody, because
right.
The truth of the matter is some people have a narrative that they have because it serves a purpose for them. Some people have a narrative because it's a part of their cultural set. It's part of their social set. In fact, I was listening to somebody describe stupidity, and they were indicating, and this was a very serious discussion about stupidity, not a joking, insulting, and they were saying that stupidity isn't even an intellectual deficit for people. Because you can have some of the most highly intelligent people who can do stupid things, but that stupidity is sometimes a function of poor information, or sometimes a function of belonging to a social group that because I belong to this social group and this is what we believe, no matter how stupid it is, I take on that belief and I carry through with that belief. That there are things that go into stupidity that don't have anything to do with having an information deficit, a knowledge deficit, or a intellectual deficit. Sometimes it's just your social profile that pushes you in that direction.
I can honestly accept that. I can accept that. But I think about this, and well, you know me personally, so you know I'm one of those people, if I don't understand, I'm going to research, I'm going to ask questions.
Right.
By nature, I don't, you know, and people could say maybe I have trust issues, but I question things.
Right.
If in my mind this does not seem logical, like I can't seem to wrap my mind around this, I'm going to question it. And even if I can, I have made a decision and I take a stance to always try to look at it from another perspective. That's me. That's right. What I, and so.
But that's intelligence. Know, that's what intelligence what, is, though. Intelligence starts, you know, you haven't noticed the people who know the most about a subject are the people who tend to be sometimes, and especially in the academic community, the humblest about it. Because they, in their coming to know, they come to know just how much they don't know.
Right.
But the people who know least about a matter and then go and do a little bit of work are the people who tend to be most dogmatic about it when they come out.
They appear to be knowledgeable. And so my point in saying that is, there, of course, that's me. There are people out there like that. But in, can we say, though, that in instances, in certain instances, if people do not know, but a narrative is coming from someone who they believe is credible or who they who have demonstrated in the past to be right about certain things, that there is a propensity not to question, but to accept what they're saying as truth.
Sure, sure.
And so that's you will find that if I believe my political leader, in them, they've demonstrated to me, whatever, and they come and they say a thing, or if what they're saying is in line with what I already think, there is that willingness to accept it, not question it, and to then push that narrative.
Mm-hmm. Sure. Sure.
And so to me, it isn't always a situation where you do not know and you don't want to know. You want to know, but you are trusting the information that you are getting from someone you trust or you believe may be credible.
Sure.
And they may have their own agenda.
Sure.
But you buy into it. Or they may not know, but they're kind of, you know, because sometimes people don't like to say they don't know. And so they go along with a narrative because they really don't know, but they just speak confidently about something.
We have a number of texts here. Let's see if we can get to these. Look at the stadium that was recently opened across from GHS. Look at how long and how much times we switched parties during its development. Yep, it continued slowly, but it did, right? The straw market was such a project, says somebody. The straw market was such a project as in what? Meaning what? What happened with the straw market? I don't know. You have to tell me what happened with the straw market.
This text look, says, look at the all-age school in the western part of Grand Bahama.
What happened with that?
That was started.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm only going according to what was in the press. They had two different contractors, and it was scheduled to open. Government changed. There was no work really done on it, and now there's being work done on it again because a new iteration of the government who had started that project is now in power.
Okay. This text
so says, those are the kind, in the grand scheme of things, you may say, big projects, government don't stop. You know, like it didn't, but people look at those things and say, okay, we're not progressing.
I still don't think that makes the point at all, though. I mean, again, I agree with you that people could look at them and say that, but it don't make the point, though, because first of all, we don't get the benefit, and you mentioned that you might need some freedom of information on it. We don't get the benefit of knowing, okay, why didn't you continue this project? Why didn't you continue the project? Like, let me give you an example of what someone might think. This is a school for what?
It was the school to replace the all-age one down in West Ham.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
And so new school, new campus.
I don't know. Again, my point is one might not know what the deliberations were that went into things. Let me tell you something that could happen. Because people only blame politicians. You could have a technical team to the government. Listen, man, you know, it's more cost effective for us to bus children from West End to 8 Mile Rock, where there is a school that blah, 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 blah. And for us to go and build that for that much money, school for that small number of people. This is the technical people, no. This is not the politicians.
Right.
Right? But the politician says, oh, but yes, my constituency, my colleague wants this, we're trying to blah, 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 and they go ahead and do it anyways. Right? Then a new administration comes in, and they haven't gone that far advanced in the construction. So somebody says, you know what, this don't make no sense. We could do otherwise, X, Y, and Z. So all kinds of things could go into that consideration, but isn't that why you elect new people? To be able to look at your resource use and to say, is this a proper use of our resources? That case was made when a $2 plus million school was being built amounted to like 30 students. And the question was that a proper use of the monies? So people to make these judgments.
Which still goes back to what I was saying. If the information is available for the public to be able to understand that, yes, of course, you're going to still have your detractors, your naysayers, the people who, when they're faced with the truth, they still want to create a narrative. But I'm saying for general people who want an understanding, if I'm operating under the impression that, okay, government changes, work has come to a stop, I don't get any further explanation other than, oh, I only see that the work has stopped and there's no explanation, there's nothing for me to access or readily available for me to access to say, okay, yeah, but this is why it was stopped.
But that does not make your observation, that does not make the statement that people make, though, an accurate statement. And this is what I'm getting to. If you say to me, I did not appreciate, I don't think it's right that a school started under this administration, was stopped under the other administration without explanation, that's one thing. But to make us that, from administration to administration, we stop things and things don't continue, that is inaccurate. And that's the point. The point is, it is an inaccurate statement because far more things continue than do not continue. Far more. That's why people can't give you a big list. They can't, because no such list exists. Right? If somebody wanted to give me an example of something starting and stopping or being reviewed, let's look at the road project. The Ingram administration started the road project, got so far, the road project wasn't completed, you know. When the government changed, because the Ingram administration lost office, the road project was modified under it was delayed and then modified and then continued only on Milo Butler Highway. Okay? So, but again, to use that as an example that things just stop because the government changed is not accurate. Because that was an example of a government changing, making the determination that the path that was being taken was not the one that they thought was best for the country, and you hired them to change things because you changed the government. What I'm saying is we have to be able to reflect in our language a more accurate description if we're going to advance the dialogue. See, because if somebody makes that statement to someone they are hanging out with, they may get no pushback. But you are going to get pushback from someone who knows better. And it doesn't have to be me. It could be any permanent secretary could tell you, or any technical person might be able to say, no, but that's not true. But what happens is we persist with these things, and all we do is create a perception about us.
We make these broad generalizations.
Exactly. And what happens, though, is it's not harmless, because it now becomes a characteristic trait or a feature or character of us.
Yeah. That's how I feel when I hear Bahamians don't like to work.
Mm-hmm. Precisely.
Bahamians are, I'm offended by that.
Well, Bahamians are lazy.
Right, Bahamians are lazy.
right? I tell people all the time, just drive up and down New Providence. Look at all those buildings. Look at all those roads. Look at all those things you see. Look at all the things you get to have happen in the Commonwealth of the Bahamas. Look at all those millions of tourists that get served. Well, who do you think serving all of them people?
Bahamians, right. And that was my bone of contention. I said, every day you were conducting, transacting business, seeing it being transacted, you are a recipient or providing service by Bahamians, but you were saying that Bahamians don't want to work. Bahamians are lazy. Where did that narrative come from and how we've perpetuated? Because we ourselves.
Absolutely. Because it went by for many years unchallenged. It's like the narrative about the degrade. Which we talk
Lord, do you really want
to? No. This text says the dump stopped burning, problem solved. Yes, the dump was a problem we had, and was it not solved?
Right.
But people who say we haven't solved any problems. Now, he said in the last 20 years, I really have to think hard. I mean, that doesn't mean problems weren't solved, but I have to.
You have to think
hard.
I've been kind of, as we've been talking, I've been trying to do research on the side because I'm still thinking about that.
Well, you could get a passport in a day if you're prepared to pay $400.
Right.
$300. So that's really, for people who are prepared to do that, that's real progress. I could say that. Yeah.
Right. But his point was solutions, right? And solution to me, to my mind, is there was a problem and it was resolved.
But that is a problem. Having to take too long to get your passport and having no option to get it earlier. That's a problem solved.
So that's a problem solved. Okay. And then also, I would go on to say, rather than solve, have we adequately addressed? Or have we put measures in place where we're attempting to address issues that we have in a meaningful and impactful way? Maybe if we look at it like that, as opposed to just trying something or things that were 100% solved.
But it's a great question, and the answer is easy. Now, over time, I could think of some things that were, you know. We used to have a crack epidemic in the Bahamas. Do you remember that? Well, you were too young for that. Yeah. In the 80s.
I remember. I was younger, but I remember.
Yeah, but that problem was solved. The problem was solved. Do you know that the Bahamas used to be a very, very smoking society? Like, people smoke a lot of cigarettes in the Bahamas.
But yes.
Do you know that the Bahamas is now one of the most smokeless societies in the world? That problem was solved by policy, you know, by policy. There was a time in the Bahamas when our infant mortality rate was out of control. Out of control. But we actually reversed that in a direction. In particular, it happened under Ingram. It was reversed seriously, and then it started to pick up again. But a deliberate effort was taken at reducing that. We used to have a significant AIDS epidemic in the Bahamas. And we addressed that problem, and AIDS increase in the Bahamas went on the decline. So we can't say we haven't fixed problems in this country. The question is, what problems have you fixed in the last 20 years? Well, that's a different story. boy, this text says, Brave came to office preaching no taxes, but never said how he would generate revenue. I thought the PLP had a money tree, especially how they were spending. Same corp of people who hounded Minister administration like dog never bothered to demand from Brave how he was going to do so. Now everyone complaining about taxes. Some are too ashamed to speak. Okay. Somebody's complaining about taxes? As in new taxes or increased taxes? I'm missing that.
I'd say increase, not additional taxes, I guess.
But which taxes were increased?
When we talk about the 12% VAT, that's now 10%, however.
Yeah, that's a decrease. Or you mean about the.
I'm not done yet.
Okay, yeah, the food.
You see? So you got the decrease. You did get a decrease.
You can't please your old man.
Zhivargo, I always say the devil is in the details. I'm never excited about anything on face value. I need the details. Give me the details so I can make a determination if this is really a good deal or not.
They ain't tricking you, eh?
No, and so right. Until then, I reserve my enthusiasm.
But overall, if on the VAT, component of it, overall, that was a tax decrease. There's no question about that. Overall, no question. Any math calculation would confirm that. Any math calculation. If you took a household spending on all items it spent in a household on a regular basis, the food component of it, the bread basket item component of it, will not amount to the amount of savings you get from the VAT decrease on the rest of the items. Could not. You'd be a strange person in terms of your spending habits to claim that. In fact, you'd have to be only probably spending on food and bread basket items in the main.
I will have to reserve my comment on that until I do proper investigation.
Yeah, do that. But the math has already been done. So I could say with confidence. The math is clear on that. That's easy math, actually. Very easy math. Right? I'm not saying it's the savings is going to be astronomical, but there's no question about it that it works out to a net benefit on savings in terms of VAT.
The food component.
I'm saying a household doesn't just spend on food. A household spends on services and other things. And the VAT was reduced on many of those things as well. So when you take the proportion of your budget that is food, it doesn't amount most times to say 30, 40%. It could not, 40% is really being generous of your bill. So when you take the savings on the rest of your bill compared to the food bill, in particular the bread basket bill, because the VAT was decreased on all the other food, but increased on the bread basket. So when you take all of those together, other than the bread basket, there's no question you get more savings on all the other things compared to the bread basket increase in VAT. And that's easy.
And then do I take those savings that I get when I calculate it like that? We also factor in now that I'm also paying VAT on medication and insurance.
Yeah.
And it still works out.
It still works out because even then the VAT was reduced. Now, where the exemption existed then, you would have to say somebody is spending upwards to 45-50%+ of their overall budget on medicine for them to have that VAT payment outpace the VAT reduction on all the other things. It doesn't in the normal circumstance, it doesn't add up. Not from a math basis. I said that a long time ago because I did any number of calculations in respect of that using a sensitivity analysis on people's food spending based on what we know to be the pattern of spending of people generally. And by the way, the pattern of spending of people is generally tracked even by the Department of Statistics, now the Bahamas Statistical Institute, National Institute. So it's really not a difficult math to calculate. So we have a text here before we take our breaks. Says software vendors make their real money on maintenance contracts or subscription services. The purchase price is often a minute percentage of anticipated revenue. This isn't necessarily a bad thing for good service, but a software vendor can lock at maintenance services for things that should have been delivered with the product. That is true. Also, you have, and the government of Bahamas was subject to this for a long time, where it had proprietary infrastructure in their information systems. They had proprietary infrastructure such that you now had to use that particular vendor to do the software. Because if you didn't, you would then have to buy all the infrastructure anew. And so we've had that situation. So this person is actually
correct,
saying something quite useful. Ladies and gentlemen, you're listening to Z Live. I'm Zhivargo Laing, your host, and I'm here with Mrs. Laverne Gardner of Mixed Views, and we're talking about a number of things. But when we come back, maybe we'll get a little more specific about the National Development Plan. We'll be back after this break.
We'll walk this road together through the storm, whatever weather, cold or warm. Let you know that you're not alone. Holla if you feel like you make it down the same road.
So much going on in the world today, only accepting cash at your business can be risky. Let Fidelity offer you and your customers safety, convenience, and the flexibility of a fixed or mobile terminal. Take it with you, on the move and on the go, because business should never stop. For more details, speak to one of our business development officers at 356-7764 in Nassau or 352-6676 in Freeport. Visit our website at fidelitygroup.com or visit us at any of our branches. We're good for
you. This is Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM. Fresh news, smart talk, quality.
I'm not afraid to take a stand, everybody, everybody, come take my hand, we'll walk this road together, through the storm, whatever weather, cold or warm, let me know that you're not alone, holla if you feel like you make it down the same road.
Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen, to Z Live. I'm Zhivargo Laing, your host. I'm so glad you could join us here today on Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM, on this beautiful Thursday afternoon, where I'm here with Mrs. Laverne Gardner of Mixed Views, and we're talking about a number of things related to some questions raised yesterday about the National Development Plan and the like, and some comments made against that backdrop. This text says, it typically happens when the purchaser is wowed by the fact that something is moving around on a screen rather than whether that thing delivers what's needed. Click to Clear is a good example. It was great software, but it wasn't exactly in the form we needed. And unfortunately, none took the time necessary to discover that until after implementation. Well, I don't know. I could tell you when we were doing the e-government platform, there was no screens and no movements on the screen that we saw that impressed anybody. We had some very dedicated professionals who were looking at the guidance from what was one of the best in class groups in the Singaporean government at the time. But you might well be right, but it wouldn't fit the narrative of the thing that I know we were involved with recently. This text says, Mr. Laing, I'm sorry for you all, but here is another one. All politicians are corrupt and on the take. Yep, I've dealt with that a number of times before.
That's an old one.
Yeah, but it's old and persistent. That's an old and persistent one,
and that's just not a narrative locally, nationally. Yeah. That's an international narrative.
And an understandable to this extent. A lot of people actually do unethical things. Right. And by that, I mean, if you go to the government place and, you know, you call up your boy or girl to do something for you and they get it spared up for you and you give them a couple of dollars, tell them you're buying them. That's not ethical. A lot of people run the red light. Well, that's against the law. OK, the difference between something and gets discovered, they are high profile and in the public view.
Right.
So many of our sins are private. Many of our unethical practices are private. Many of our immoral behaviors are private. But the public figures, as ought to be the case, get all of their stuff, the private and the public stuff, in the public face. So when it gets blown up, And you know what happens is you blow it up, the dust falls on everybody, and everybody looks dirty from the dust. That's not quite understandable, right? On the other hand, pastors are many times regarded unfavorably these days. Why? Because people are trying to get from under the thumb of the moral imperatives that they represent, right? I mean, I feel free if, you know, I was in condemned or convicted by this righteousness, you know, and then all of a sudden these high profile people, all of them like that.
I think that's part and parcel at this point of public life to a certain extent, that you are under greater scrutiny because you are public, more accessible.
Yes.
And, you know, we are very good in life in this world at generalizations and just brushing everybody with the same stroke. But before we run out of time, I want us to go back to the national development plan that you indicated we will say is underfoot. And let's talk about that. Even if we don't know, have details, or you're unable to share details, what that would look like. And what I mean is every island has a separate plan? Okay, what do we want this island to be known for? Looked at, focus, what is going to be our focus? Well, are we making best use of what resources, natural resources they have available and the such?
Well, firstly, let me say, because somebody did text and ask, if you go to vision2040bahamas.org, vision2040bahamas.org, you can see a copy of the National Development Plan. I have it on my computer screen right now. A National Development Plan to guide the future of the Bahamas is what it says, right? And like any plan, what it will do is it will lay out, first of all, the national vision. What's the vision for the country? And then what it will do is it will lay out the national mission. What is the mission for the country? And that's like any plan, what you want to do is you want to break the plan down into goals. And so then it will describe what the national goals are and so forth, right? And then when you go forward from there, it then tends to go break the goals down into tasks and say who is supposed to be responsible for fulfilling that task and so forth and so forth. So that's broadly what the plan lays out. So the plan is not structured now where it's the plan for Andras, it's the plan for Eleuthera and so forth, but it does talk about using the various island to leverage their own development as a part of the national development planning. Now, this plan is quite a advanced piece of work in terms of a dialogue toward a national development plan. What the plan does not have, and there are about 120 national plans in existence today. This plan, like many of them, does not have a financial component of it. So it's not been costed out and that kind of stuff. It does not now have what you call targets, performance indicators, except to the extent that the Government and Public Policy Institute has for all of the goals of the plan now presented to the government performance indicators that could be looked at so that you could monitor the evaluate and monitor the progress of the plan. So we've advanced it to that extent. We've advanced some recommendations about what can be done to provide some financing for the plan and integrating that financing into the national budget exercise on an annual basis. So there is a lot there. And I could promise you, you need to spend the time to at least read that so that you can then participate in the discussion. One of the things that has not happened with this plan yet is it hasn't been the subject of broad public consultations. But the plan organizers had conceded that and has asked that the next step be to conduct those national consultations on the plan, the proposed plan, the draft plan. Okay?
Hello?
Yes, yes. You go ahead, caller. We're listening to you.
Mr. Laing, how are you?
I'm okay, man. And yourself?
I'm pretty good. I recently paid off my mortgage.
Okay.
In Grand Bahama.
Okay.
I ran to the bank to collect my deeds and my paperwork. Okay. The bank informs me now that I have to take my conveyance to the Department of Inland Revenue and see if I owe any real property tax.
Okay. In Grand Bahama or Freeport? You live in Freeport?
Freeport
proper.
Yeah.
Yeah, but you don't owe inland nothing because you don't pay property taxes in Freeport.
My point exactly. That's the same thing I explained to the bank, but they still insist.
What they should have done was to send you to, and your bank would have done this, but this would, since your mortgage is paid off, this doesn't even arise. They could send you to the Port Authority to see if you owed anything in terms of service fees, but you do not pay real property taxes to the government on land in Freeport.
And that's exactly what I explained to the bank. I say, hey, we in Freeport area, we don't pay real property tax, we pay service charge.
No,
you still have to get a satisfaction from the Department of Inland.
Well, you could do that, and all they will say is, no, this place isn't over, so no problem, you should do that.
It just seemed kind of odd to me, because I remember when I initially built the house.
No, but that's okay. I think what they're doing is they're trying to satisfy their files in terms of documentations about things. And so, I mean, it might be a nuisance for you, but I mean, it's no big deal for you because you ain't owe nothing.
Yeah, I know.
Yeah. But you're right. But again, I think this is just something that they're trying to do for their files. And so, you know, you do what you got to do.
Yeah, it has to be. And let me just say that because we received the same thing.
Yeah. I think that's just a part of the file for their file, so that in any due diligence exercise, they want to have.
Let me just add to this. The bank did tell me that the law just changed, and the part of the law just changed, and now I have to bring that document.
That could very well be it. So no problem. It could very well be it. You know, maybe even the government is using that to make sure that their files are complete about the taxpayers in the country and where their properties are in fact located. Because just because you don't pay taxes doesn't mean the government doesn't want a record of your ownership of the land, because in the future you may, because the Hawkes-Wilkie agreement may actually expire that provision of it may expire to cause you to pay taxes, you know, credit. It was expired and then the government renewed it twice. It may not be renewed again.
Well, I mean, correct me if I'm wrong, but the part that was expired, I believe that's to do with the industrial sector, wasn't it?
No. The part that expired had to do with paying real property taxes.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right, then. Thank you.
You're quite welcome. Okay. All right. We're going to take our final break, ladies and gentlemen, and then when we come back, do we have a call on the line? Maybe I shouldn't let them hold. We have another call on the line? Go ahead, caller. Okay, maybe not. So we'll take a break, ladies and gentlemen. When we come back, we'll continue our conversation. We'll be back after this break.
I ain't marched the car. The lady run into me marched the car.
I hope she had insurance.
If she had insurance, she hop out, pull out her phone, pull up the Royal Star Assurance app, and bang, she was on a video call with an RSA rep, sending pictures of her damage, my damage, filing a claim on the spot.
For real? Our insurance have that kind of app?
You gotta go to RSA for that.
Download the RSA app today, or visit rsabahamas.com to submit your claim online. Live chat available weekdays 9 to 5.
What risks do inflation, soaring energy prices, and global tensions pose to the Caribbean? Join international experts, local professionals, and policymakers at the 9th annual RF Economic Outlook. Be part of the conversation on March 14th by reserving your seat today at rfbeo.com. RFEO 2023 is proudly sponsored by RF Bank and Trust, Alive Doctors Hospital, Fidelity Bank, J.S. Johnson, PwC, and The Tribune.
This is Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM. All day.
I'm not afraid to take a stand, take a stand. Everybody, everybody, come take my hand, come take my hand. We'll walk this road together through the storm, whatever weather, cold or warm. Send you know that you're not alone. All up if you feel like you've been down the same road.
Join us here today on Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM. I'm going to get through some of these texts, Laverne, before we that done. This text says, how is that the bank's business? Except the government mandates it, I really don't see how it's the bank's business. If you satisfied your mortgage, I really don't. I don't know how that's the bank's business. But, you know, in this country, it has been my observation that institutions ask you for far more information than that is relevant to your transactions with them. And I found myself a couple of times recently telling the institutions I will not answer that question. I told them just that, and they told me, okay, well, we'll just note that. And I said, I won't, because it has no relevance whatsoever for what I am seeking to do with you. This text says, one correction, Mr. Lai, I could be wrong, but this current Bahamas is actually a very smoking country, sadly too. No, I don't think you're right at all about that. When I say smoking, like, you want to talk about a smoking country, go to Canada and parts of the United States of America where people smoke profusely, all right? Where they got smoking areas so people could smoke. Bahamas is not like that. And if you just think about your own movement up and down amongst your general associates and what have you, how many of them smoke? Not very many at all. You want to see smoking? Trust me. Ever that, Laverne?
No, not at all.
Yeah. We are not a smoking society.
I remember we traveled to Cuba, and when we got to the airport, I could not breathe.
Yeah.
Everywhere.
Yeah. We are not a smoking society. This text is, can you advise on the status of the case tracking software for the judicial service? I have no idea what is happening with that. Sorry, I don't. A person that asked about the copy of the plan. This text says, afternoon, M215 Education Minister Fitzgerald engaged in a $1.5 million management computer system for diagnostics, assessment, remediation that tracks the performance of every student from K-12 to GR. Therefore, the learning loss from COVID-19 could easily be identified without cost. Technical continuity seems to be a problem, and recently, a new foreign team was engaged to collect, compile the same data. Yeah, sometimes, as I said, the technical issues could exist with respect to that. It says, hi, what about the GIN project in Grand Bahama? Did that not start and stop for good? Yeah, but that wasn't because, and that had nothing to do with the government, though. The GIN people had legal and money issues. That had nothing to do with
right.
That. Yeah, so that's nothing to do with the government. This text says, it's about past 5 years since Mr. Lester Cox made the point of implementing city government. Okay. I don't understand what that means. This text says, good day, Mr. Laing. Please explain why both political parties refuse to implement income tax in any form of it. Well, for the longest time, nobody in the Bahamas wanted to implement income tax because it would have severe implications for your financial services sector. People who play in your sector for many years, not probably now, but for many years, were averse to things like income tax, corporate taxes. They were running from jurisdictions where those things were being implemented. And so they're seeing you as a non-income tax, corporate tax, inheritance tax jurisdiction, gave them and made them come to you, and therefore you got all those nice paying jobs and all that monies to manage and all that kind of stuff and all the professional service fees attendant to that. And so for that reason, income taxes were regarded as not a good thing. Even today, if you implemented income tax in the Bahamas, taxing Bahamians alone could not give you the revenue that you would require and the level of taxation you would have to do in order to get it from Bahamas, you would not be able to sustain. So income tax is not a panacea for us, even though it would be a fairer tax and probably something we will have to do and should do sometime soon. It's not the fix-all for us. This text says, good day, Mr. Laing, please. He without sin cast the first stone. Okay, well, I ain't throwing no stones at nobody. So,
says, I don't understand that.
Listen, man, you know, the listeners to these shows are many, varied, and have all kinds of things in their heads. Says, great informative show. I'm learning a lot. Keep up the good work. You are quite welcome. Steck says, I think about 1 year or so, the government approached declaring Banks Association to collect real property tax and or confirm its in applicability for properties which are the subjects of mortgages. Okay, see, I my suspicion is that the government required something to be done. So there you go. So I don't know when you can get a national development plan, Madam Gardner. I don't know when you're gonna have one.
We're gonna have to help this out by, you know, doing our homework, going on, I don't want to misquote, vision2040.org, and then, you know, dedicate between our shows once per month to advance the conversation.
Yeah. But we are also at the Government and Public Policy Institute working with the government to try to move that project along, because the, you know, there is a facility for monitoring and evaluating the National Development Plan. And, you know, the absence of that formal plan does not mean there is not a plan. There could be a plan, as in some things you're seeking to do for the nation, but this formal adopted plan is part of a collective understanding of where we're headed and how we propose to get there. This text says, good afternoon. Read a caller from Freeport. The bank may have a policy that they will not release any documents if the property owner owes taxes on properties outside Freeport. No, that can't be in relation to a property which you've satisfied the mortgage on. If I didn't pay you all the money that I owed you, give me my deed. I can't see you holding up my deed for any reason, inclusive of getting a satisfaction from the government that I don't owe no property taxes. Because if I owe the government property taxes, what does that have to do with me having paid you your mortgage?
This is
the kind of thing that happens, that if you're not thinking, you will let people put stuff on you that don't make no sense. If right. I have satisfied your mortgage, but I owe the government, what does that have to do with you giving me my deed? If the government wants to come and track me down for its money, that's a different story. What is it to be thinking?
Is it possible that the Stu was saying that the government may have sent out a mandate to these clearing banks?
That may well be so, but that has nothing to do still with ICE. Why were you holding my document? Because I owed you money.
New money.
Right? That's the only reason why. And you have no relationship outside of that. Now that I paid you all your money, I'm asking you for my deed, and you can't release it because you're telling I want a satisfaction letter from the government that I don't owe the government no money. So if the government says I owe them money, you're going to tell me you're going to hold my deed, notwithstanding I owe you no money, because I owe the government? But what if I owe my uncle or my auntie? Seriously? My credit card company? That makes no sense. Makes no sense. And he's right to make the point he's making. I was only saying there, man, don't hold up yourself with people doing fool.
But he was right to query it.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. Makes no sense. Now, maybe the way he put it, there is not the proper understanding. I don't know, but it doesn't, on the face of it, make sense. This text says, good afternoon, Mr. Laing. I live in Nassau. I have already paid off my mortgage, and the bank is saying to me that in order for me to get my document papers, I must have my real property tax be paid up to date. But again, that Nassau, right? Like, I don't even understand that. I don't understand that. I just don't understand that. But maybe there's a legal aspect of it I don't understand. So let me make that clear. Maybe some lawyer could clear that up and say, you know, well, the Zhivargo, here's the contingent, something, something, I don't know. Says, but the same way they have private sector collecting the government's VAT, they figure they will get them to administer the VAT or the day taxes too. You could be right. And I mean, it could be a way the government, them trying to do their due. This says IZ, first charge on property is real property tax, ranks ahead of the government, ranks ahead of any mortgage. Yes, it ranks ahead of the mortgage, but you're holding my deed though. The bank holding my deed. I don't owe the bank no money no more. If the government wants to come behind and say, listen, you owe me, you don't pay me, I'm going to claim on this problem, let the government do that. But right. Why is the bank holding up my deed though?
As if they are now the collection agency exactly. For the government.
Absolute nonsense. Listen, unless a lawyer explains to me this and says to me, Zhivargo, here's the legal parameter, I just don't get it. I don't see it. This text says the banks are currently doing this with deeds. It should be illegal. I'm in this very position right now. In fact, it is the current law, but it seems improper to me. Wow. Okay. Maybe we need to get some clarifications. So I'll see if we can find someone who can help us appreciate this. Let me tell you something. Everything the government does, everything the banks do, even some things the lawyers say, don't make sense. That's why the lawyers go take lawyers to court so the courts could adjudicate the matter. It says non-payment of real property tax would be mean as a first charge on the property. This is all the same. Listen, y'all, first charge on what though? First charge on what? If I do not owe the bank any money, why is the bank holding my property? Not the government to whom I owe the real property tax. None of this explains anything to me. I'm not saying they all ain't right. I'm just saying don't explain that to me. Say they won't satisfy the mortgage if property tax outstanding. Fact. Okay. All right. Now that's somebody who's a banker who knows. So, okay. I got you. They won't satisfy it. That doesn't mean that's the rule. That's how it goes. So, folk, satisfy your real property tax so you can get your deed. Ladies and gentlemen, you've been listening to Z Live. I'm Zhivargo Laing, your host. I've been here with Laverne Gardner and of Mixed Views. God bless you. We'll